For the past 50 years, Daktronics has been innovating and engineering new solutions for our customers. Today, we are the world leader in designing and manufacturing electronic scoreboards, programmable display systems, and large screen video displays. With locations across the globe, our products are everywhere, from small to large businesses, high schools, colleges, professional sports, roadways, billboards, airports, and beyond. With local support across the U.S. and worldwide, we build long-lasting relationships to provide our customers with the best possible product and service. This is our story. Two South Dakota State University professors, Dr. Al Kurtenbach and Dr. Dwayne Sander, founded the company in 1968 with a goal to provide opportunities for recent graduates to stay in South Dakota.
And the resource, primary resource, was talent, and the talent was right there in the classroom. So I didn't have to go searching for it. We just had to further develop the talent, encourage them to step out.
We wanted to do something that would really enhance the lives of people throughout the area.
I grew up on a farm, and farms are small businesses, and I enjoyed that part.
Experience on the farm provided the foundation for running a business and inspired the hard work ethic that is instilled in our culture to this day. It also inspired our core values: honest, helpful, and humble. On a long car ride home from Ohio, inspiration struck. Al came up with the name for the new company.
I was thinking of this name thing, and that's where I came up with the contraction Daktronics. And I took a piece of paper and that was probably in the seat beside me, and scratched it on there and put it up on the dash so I wouldn't forget my verbiage.
Initially, we planned to design and manufacture equipment for hospital and medical uses. Realizing we didn't have sufficient funds to enter that market, we began to look for other opportunities.
I was subscribing to the Wall Street Journal, and back then it was just kind of a thin paper. It wasn't so thick as it is now. They'd pile up all week, and I'd kind of browse through them on Friday night or Saturday morning. And this one Friday night, I was browsing through it, and here the state of Utah was serious about, they had an advertisement for bids in the Wall Street Journal.
The state of Utah was looking for a company to make and install an electronic voting system in its House of Representatives. One glance at the article was all it took for our company to change its course and pursue its first big opportunity.
We were out there trying to sell the system, and I was riding in an elevator with three or four people, and one of the people asked a purchaser why they were even considering a new startup, and he said, everyone has to start somewhere.
The engineers were madly designing it because they sold it before, of course, it was designed. That was pretty natural for us back then.
Electronic voting systems were the bread and butter. Those were anywhere from, I'd say, $100,000 up to maybe $400,000, which was a huge order for Daktronics.
From voting systems, we got our first introduction into the sporting world by developing the mat side wrestling scoreboard. Wrestling scoring systems at the time weren't ideal, and a wrestling coach at South Dakota State University approached us with a challenge.
Two major pitfalls with what they were using. One was that it didn't show the right information, and the other was that it blocked the view of the fans. And so that brought us to this model. And with that truncated pyramid structure.
For this project, we hired our first student, Jim Morgan, as a full-time employee. Years later, he would become our president and CEO.
They had a commitment to have these at a tournament in February, and this was December 1st. We designed the circuitry and had some help from others getting it designed, and then we opened Daktronics' first factory, which was a little shop we rented on the south end of Main Street, and and we built the first mat sides there.
The mat side was an instant success and wowed the crowds at the NCAA tournament in 1971. From there, we entered the high school sports market and expanded into the commercial market with time and temperature displays. Orders were coming fast. To help with the increased workload, we had to bring in more help. Once again, we turned to university students.
Most of us there were just a bunch of farm kids who didn't know what we weren't supposed to be able to do. And as you probably know, farm kids can do quite a few things just because of the experience they've had with machinery and other things on the farm. We just did what needed to be done.
I believe it was 12 or 13 football scoreboards, and we had to have them delivered by football season. So that was a rough summer.
Because of the lack of manufacturing space, we built many of our scoreboards outside our facility on Madera Avenue in Brookings.
If we didn't close everything up really tight, we would turn things on and start testing in the morning and wipe out all the low voltage circuitry.
It was a clear sign we needed to expand. So in 1974, we moved into a new 14,000 square foot manufacturing space on the east side of Brookings, the location we continue to call home. But even this space wouldn't be large enough for what was about to come.
Daktronics got the contract for the Winter Olympics. The
Lake Placid Olympic Organizing Committee would like to have some U.S. built product. And so they contacted us, and we worked with them then to get a proposal in and get a contract signed.
We provided 9 scoreboards for the 1980 Winter Olympics, which included the center-hung scoreboard from the famous Miracle on Ice.
And I think once we got that Olympic contract, that put us on the map. Daktronics was a small business. All of a sudden we had people who now knew who we were. Our name was out there. People that I knew, almost all my friends, were amazed that here we are building the Olympic scoreboards.
To be able to be selling and to be able to say we are doing the scoreboards for the Olympics helped so much to establish credibility.
This wouldn't be the only Olympic Games we would be involved in. We had significant contracts for the Games through 2004, providing products and support. Many Olympic venues continue to use our products to this day. The first Olympic contract charted a clear path for our small electronics company from South Dakota and opened new doors for business. In 1986, we acquired the new Glow Cube technology, leading to a contract with the PGA Tour. Our engineers developed an ingenious scoring system, a low-power, portable solution.
That was an exciting project to work on. We had about 3 months to develop a whole new system.
It's one project that still stands out for Al.
Oh, my favorite one, it was the PGA Tour boards. And it was a system that required a lot of different aspects. The specifications were interesting, like it's got to be transportable. It has to be able to be installed in 2 days.
The development of GlowCube technology tested the capabilities of our entire company that still had less than 1,000 employees.
Very intense time for the company. It's one of the times that the whole company had to really come together. We would design parts through the afternoon, and the manufacturer would start to build parts, and then we would start to put them together. It was fun because the whole company really came together to make it happen. It was definitely a whole company affair.
It was around this time we also found a niche in the transportation market, offering us a new set of opportunities.
And mass transit systems, airports, so many different applications that we could put our products back at that time. It brought us into casinos and financial institutions.
We successfully won an order with the Connecticut Department of Transportation and installed our first roadway system in 1988. To this day, we're still finding new ways to inform and assist travelers to safely reach their destinations.
We put our displays in places that there's a lot of people around. We are everywhere when it comes to transportation. It touches so many areas.
Our biggest technological breakthrough was yet to come. In the early 1990s, LED technology was becoming the cat's meow of the industry, and we were quick to jump at the opportunity.
That was an exciting time, and that's when you realize that this technology is going to open new doors for not only Daktronics, but just for, you know, the marketplace in general. Applications that didn't exist before could be possible now.
We perfected LED video display technology and began winning contracts for major universities and eventually professional sports teams.
And that put us in conflict with some of these big video companies like Panasonic, Mitsubishi, Sony. These were our big competitors.
So that was a monumental time within the history of Daktronics' career, because after we got those video board installs, our growth was phenomenal for the next 10, 12 years. We started becoming a key player, a main player, a reliable source for video displays, not only in major league sports, but also in the college university market.
The technology also brought us the chance to install our first display in Times Square in 1995.
It was a project that kind of pushed the envelope of what we could do. It was our first major attempt at doing large format LED displays. Even though they're monochrome, we started out with virtually no product and ended up about 18 months later with an installation in Times Square that lasted for over 18 years.
We lit up the market and became a publicly traded company in 1994, making good on promises made to early investors. Offices and factories started popping up across the country and around the world. By the early 2000s, our Brookings campus rapidly expanded from 14,000 square feet to 15 acres to accommodate the explosive growth our company was going through.
We were so fortunate to have opportunities that we had at that point. The industry was booming, the economy was booming, lots of advertising dollars were being spent, which is good for us. And we were able to capture quite a bit of that business.
That was a real go-go time. We just couldn't hire enough people at the time because things were growing so fast.
It's a stark contrast to the first years of our company and a time that wouldn't have been possible without the constant vision and guidance of our founders.
When Al and Dwayne started the company, they didn't have a product. So the first probably 10 years are more years of survival.
Al's interviewing is, let's go have a cup of coffee. So we went to the Starlight, had a cup of coffee, and we just had good conversation, and he talked about all the different opportunities that he envisioned for Daktronics. And it's not just in the United States, this is all around the world where we're going to be doing this work.
He was so positive and was so dedicated to make this work that I guess we never thought that it wouldn't.
Perseverance sometimes pays off, and we made it.
Our future is bright. Our more than 2,500 dedicated employees, located on nearly every continent in the world, are going after our customers' toughest challenges and developing solutions for them. It's not always easy, but we never give up.
People at Daktronics tend to run towards the challenge and say, how can we help?
As we're full of really good, hardworking people doing their best to do the right thing. And I think there's a lot of good that comes from that.
Teamwork is something that one of the things that I really enjoyed working for Daktronics. It really is something kind of like spirit that runs across our organization.
I think our culture at Daktronics is to be optimistic, and I'm confident that 50 years from now will look like something that we couldn't even completely anticipate it, today, and I think it's going to be great.
Our people know how to do it and do a good job.
From the beginning, we've been pushing the technological boundaries to create solutions for our customers, and our ingenuity and innovation has remained a driving force. Our engineers are hard at work preparing for the next 50 years, continually striving to maintain our position as the world leader in audiovisual communication systems. Now in our 50th year, we've released the second generation of our narrow pixel pitch line and are perfecting the use of chip-on-board technology.
I think it's going to allow us to be in applications that we hadn't been in the past. We'll definitely provide our customers with great value, and they'll be able to make use of spaces utilizing our narrow pixel pitch product that they hadn't in the past.
Technology can change on a dime, That's why we're constantly learning and working alongside the next generation of innovators to advance the way our customers communicate. There's no question Al and Dwayne achieved their goal of providing opportunities for university graduates in South Dakota. More than 700 of our employees began their careers as students. In our 5 decades of business, more than 8,000 students have worked here.
If we had said that it's going to be a worldwide company in 50 years, I think they would have thought we were a little crazy. So,
from a small garage to a global presence, we became the world leader with the guidance of 2 small town boys from South Dakota. Here's to the next 50 years of innovation.